Why would an all-loving God allow and in places seem to support slavery? Does that really make sense with the loving God that we read about in Scripture? Now, when people think of slavery, the typical image we have in mind is the slave trade over the past couple hundred years, yes, about going to certain countries and rounding people up and taking them out and selling them as property, and slave owners who were complete owners of the slave. The slaves had no rights in that sense. The Civil War, right? And so that's kind of what we have in mind when we think of slavery. And it's a good question. Why would a loving God allow something like that to happen? Or did an all-loving God actually allow something like that to happen? Why would God support slavery? This is how some people have put it. God, in this meme, yes, because we're in that age and that generation, could have banned slavery or shellfish. Shellfish. He chose shellfish. That's the mindset of a lot of people. Like, God could have said no slavery, or he could have said no shellfish, and he picked the shellfish instead of slavery. Like, why would an all-loving God choose to ban certain foods, but somehow not ban this practice of slavery? People on both sides of the slavery debate used Scripture throughout the years. 1 Peter 2:18 says, "Servants or slaves, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh." Slaves, submit to your masters. Obey them no matter how they treat you. And you can imagine during the American Civil War, that verse was quoted by a lot of people to support this idea of slavery. Plus, there's many references in the Old Testament, which we'll get to here in a moment. Ruth Green said, "It was the Old and New Testament of the Bible that were the authority for keeping humanity in serfdom for centuries and for legitimizing slavery in America, making a bloody civil war necessary to give slaves human rights under our Constitution." And so they see Scripture as being the cause of these issues. They see slavery, many people who are not believers in Scripture, see Scripture as being a problem in this area. On the flip side, you had those who used other verses in Scripture, like Galatians 3:28, which says there's neither Jew nor Greek, there's neither slave nor free, there's neither male nor female, for you are all one man in Christ Jesus. So on one side, the Bible says slaves submit to your masters. On the other side, it says in the eyes of God, there's not slave and free. You're all equal in Jesus Christ. You all have equal value, have equal worth, and there's no hierarchy in the kingdom of God based on these earthly statuses. Matthew 7:12 says, "Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them." And so people use that verse. Obviously, you don't want to be a slave, so don't have a slave. You don't want someone to take you captive, so don't take them captive. So the question is, does the Bible support slavery? And if it does support slavery, what is slavery in Scripture? If it does support slavery, what does it mean by slavery? George Carey says, "Don't let anyone tell you that biblical slavery was somehow less brutal than slavery in the United States. Without exception, biblical societies were slave-holding societies." And the problem is, that's completely wrong. It's completely wrong to say that the slave community or the slave laws in the Old Testament were the same as in the America Civil War time period. They're actually extremely, extremely different, and that turns out to be the biggest problem. Now, he is correct that in biblical times, there were a lot of other societies that treated slaves in the same way, in a brutal way, like they were treated 200 years ago. So there were many societies around the Israeli people, around the Jewish people, around Israel, that did treat slaves in a horrible way. But you actually will notice that Israel stands out among all those nations in how God told them and why God told them to treat slaves, okay? So this is what we have. First off, understand that many things in the Old Testament are not God's perfect will. They are allowed, though, or necessary for a certain reason. Here's what I mean. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Everything was very good. Obviously, there weren't slaves. Okay? God's perfect will, that would have never happened. However, because sin has entered the world, certain things exist for certain reasons. Okay? And when you look at this issue of like divorce, in the Old Testament, God says that they are allowed to divorce for one specific reason of adultery. But in the New Testament, Jesus even says, look, it's not like that's what God wants. That's not God's will. It was because you're stubborn and you wanted something, and so God gave you something. But that doesn't mean that it's the ideal situation. So understand, just because it'd be equivalent, and I'm getting way ahead of myself, basically saying, I believe we should have a prison system today does not mean that having to put people in prison is the best scenario in the world. Obviously, no criminals would be a better situation, okay? But given what we have, what does the Old Testament say about slavery? From the get-go, people have this idea that the Old Testament God is this aggressively wrathful, vengeful, hateful God, and Jesus is the lovey-dovey acceptance of everybody God, and that there's some massive difference between the Old and the New Testament. The love your neighbor is the New Testament, the kill your neighbor is the Old Testament. So just so we get things straight as we go into the Old Testament first and then the New Testament and how they treat slavery, Leviticus 19 verse 18 says, you shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudges against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. This idea of loving your neighbor and treating people well does not start with Jesus. And a lot of the merciful passages in Scripture are in the Old Testament, and Jesus talks more about hell than anybody else. So don't tell me there's this dichotomy of the loving and wrath, or the loving God, the wrathful God. God is consistent throughout all of Scripture. He is a loving God, but he is a just God at the same time, and that's clear throughout all of revealed Scripture. So what about these situations? So Israel needed to do something about the people they conquer, prisoners of war basically, the people that are fighting against them, that they take captive instead of killing. What do you do with those people? And then what do you do with criminals? Jewish criminals. People who are either in debt, who aren't paying back their debt, who abuse someone else's land, who steals from someone. How do you treat criminals, especially those in debt, all right, those who have borrowed and not returned? And what do you do with the foreign nations who you have conquered? And next week we talk about that in more detail. How do you treat their people? What's an appropriate system? So when God uses Israel to enforce his justice, what should that look like? When someone borrows money and doesn't return it, what should happen? Now, today, we'd put them in jail. That's what we would do in our society. If someone is, you know, tax evasion, they go to prison. That's our answer. And they wait it out in prison, and then they get out and go back to their life. And certainly, it's hard to go back to your life after that. But they just go back, yes? You just spend your time in prison, then you go back. In the Israeli society, they didn't use prisons like we use today. If someone was in debt, they didn't lock them up for 10 years. They had a different system in order to handle these people. And so you have to compare as we go throughout today, what's actually better? The Israeli slave system, okay, which we're going to explain exactly what Scripture says it was, or the modern day prison system. How many here have a problem with prisons in the sense of criminals get locked up? Well, I'm not necessarily our abuses of the prison system or how much we use it, or just the idea. We're all okay with someone who robs a bank going to jail. Okay? Simple enough. So we are okay with justice in that sense, with some punishment for a trespass, for harming others. And so you actually compare these prisons even more harsh than the Old Testament regulations on slaves. So here's what we know. First, Slavery in the Old Testament was designed first to get someone out of debt. That was the primary use. That is not the only use, but that's the primary use. Exodus 22, 1 through 3 says, "If a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it, he shall restore 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. He should make full restitution. If he has nothing, then he shall be sold for his theft." He shall be sold for his theft. Basically, he will then have to work and get paid until he can pay that debt off. So he is sold into slavery. He spends his time working for, you know, a year or two, whatever it may be. And then he is released when he has paid back his debt. So instead of just saying, you sit in prison and that person loses everything they had, you just sit in prison and when that time is done, go back. Their system said, you stole from him, so you're going to work for this guy over here until you pay him back. And so it's actually superior in the minds of many because it's actually restitution for what was happened, not just waiting out your time. Second, it was designed for criminals or for those who Israel had conquered, as opposed to killing them. Which one would you prefer? Slavery or death? Now, you may be thinking slavery if you're thinking Civil War time period, but once you hear how they treated their slaves, you will be on our side that it was a far better answer. And you need to understand the people that they're dealing with, the surrounding nations, these are not people who were just, la 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 la, we treat everybody so lovely, and then the Israelites captured them and put them as slaves. These are people who God, again, this is next week's topic, who God used Israel as his tool to punish for the abominations and for the horrific acts that they were committing. The most notable in Scripture is going to be child sacrifice of the surrounding nations. So the word slave in the Hebrew, it can be translated servant or slave. Some translations move it all to say servant because that sounds less bad. It really doesn't matter. You just need to understand what it means, okay? Whatever word we put on it, slave, servant, what does Scripture mean? And the Old Testament tells us what it means. Keep in mind, though, this term applies to Moses, to Abraham, to Joseph, to Abraham's head servant or slave, who he calls his son, right, who he tries to make heir. I mean, he's very loving of this individual. They were all servants of God, and Abraham's servant certainly was a servant of Abraham. But this is a term that many take on, and many are assigned because of their relationship with God. They serve God in that sense. Now, about slavery, Job 31 gives us a good starting point for how the Bible says to treat your slave. Job 31, 13 through 15 says, "If I have despised the cause of my male or female servant when they complained against me, what then shall I do when God rises up? When he punishes, how shall I answer him? Did not he who made me in the womb make them? Did not the same one fashion us in the womb?" And so the Bible, from the very beginning, it's quite possible that Job is the oldest written document in Scripture. If not, it's certainly one of the oldest. From the very beginning, the biblical approach to slavery is they're equal. While one of them may be repaying a debt, while one of them may work for the other, they are equal in the eyes of God, and we will be put on account. Job said, "I am going to be held accountable for how I treat them, and if I don't pay attention to them, and if I neglect them, and if I'm harsh with them, that's how God likely will treat me." And so we see that from the very beginning, slaves were to be treated well according to God. One of the notable ones, which we talked about, Eleazar, he's Abraham's servant, and he's described as his son. He's described as a member of his household. He's given to steward or govern over all of Abraham's possessions. They trusted them. This was not like you see in America 200 years ago. Slaves often chose to stay where they were in the Old Testament. Deuteronomy 15, 16 through 17 says, And if it happens that he says to you, I will not go away from you, because he loves you and your house, since he prospers with you, then you shall take an owl and thrust it through his ear to the door. I know that sounds really harsh, but remember, this is his decision. This is just symbolic of how you show that he's a lifelong servant now and part of that family. And he shall be your servant forever. Also to your female servant you shall do likewise. So it says, look, if they want to stay your servant forever, you let them. Because most of them were treated very well. Most of them became part of the family in that sense. It was more like, it was more like a maid for most of them. Not in every situation. I'm not going to say it was everybody. But for most of them, it was like a butler or a maid who becomes very much integrated to that family. Their home is there. Their life is there. They are being provided there. And so that's why they choose to stay, because, as it says, many of them love their masters. So the biblical view on slavery. Here is eight, I believe it is, thoughts that I have from the Old Testament. First, it was a mutually beneficial relationship that often helped the slave get out of debt and become truly free. And even after this happened, as we saw a moment ago, they often chose to stay. But it was a mutually beneficial relationship. The master has a worker who he pays in order for that debt to ultimately get paid off. Two, if masters abuse their slaves can legally run away. And that's not something you usually hear in terms of what the Bible teaches. When you're trying to make this look like Civil War slavery, that certainly wasn't an option, all right? But legally, Deuteronomy 23:15-16, you shall not give back to his master the slave who has escaped from his master to you. He may dwell with you in your midst, in the place which he chooses, within one of your gates where it seems best for him. You shall not oppress him, oppress him. You, if he runs away from his master, in the context of if his master is treating him harshly, is abusing him, he can run away and find a new master in order to work off that debt or in order to live out and serve out that slavehood or whatever that equivalent of a sentence is to pay off whatever debt or trespass that he has. So this will ensure that masters treat their slaves well because they can leave. Okay? Now one thing, and I'm pretty sure it's this one. I should know that for sure, but I'm pretty sure it's this one. If I remember correctly, this is the one that applied to Jews, okay? Not to the prisoners of war, basically, okay? This one was applicable to the Jews who were citizens. It wasn't because of some race thing, we'll get there. It was because they are citizens of Israel, all right? They're the Jewish people in that sense. And so this is something applicable mostly to the debt slaves, okay, which is what most of the Jewish slaves were. They were in debt working it off. So it was the Jewish ones in this case, not the nations who they conquered who could just go wherever they wanted, all right? So that is something I got ahead of myself, but we are on the point where it's most applicable. So does this sound anything like slave trading that you heard about in history? All those slaves who could run away and pick a new master to make sure that they had a great master, and all those slaves who love their master to the point where they were asking them to stay. Sound familiar? No, I mean, it's not your normal picture of slavery, and that's because Scripture, what God allowed and what Israel did was nothing like slavery that we see today. Third point, the slave trade was illegal. You were not allowed to buy and sell humans. You weren't allowed to trade them in that sense. Exodus 21:16. He who kidnaps a man and sells him, or if he is found in his hand, shall surely be put to death. It's pretty strict. You may not go over there, kidnap, and sell someone as a... The slave trade was illegal under penalty of death. And so certainly nothing like what we had here in early America. Racism had nothing to do with, slavery had nothing to do with race, with skin color. That's not what it was about. We look at slavery over the past 200 or 300 years. Much of it is driven by racism. When you looked at the African slave trade, the Aboriginal slave trade, a lot of it was driven by this idea that there's some inferior race, there's some inferior species, and so we can treat them in this way because they're not equal. Leviticus 19:34 says, "The strangers who dwells among you shall be to you as one born among you, and you shall love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God." And so the Bible is very much not saying slavery for the sake of racism. And we'll come back even more to that question in just a moment. As I said earlier, one or two of these are very specific to the Jewish people, the one about running away being the most prominent one. Deuteronomy 10:17-19. "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality nor takes a bribe. He administers justice for the fatherless and the widow, and loves the stranger, giving him food and clothing. Therefore, love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." It doesn't matter if they're foreigners. It doesn't matter if they're non-Jewish. It wasn't about race in that sense in the Old Testament. Slavery, nothing to do with race. It had to do, were you an enemy of the state or a criminal? Were you in debt? Those are what it had to do with, and those alone. Acts 17:26, just one more on this topic, and then we'll move on. "And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwelling." Everybody is the same blood. All nations are the same blood. There are not these different races, one inferior or one superior. Fifth thought, slaves received Sabbath rest. Slaves receive Sabbath rest, Exodus 20:10. "But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates." Nobody works on the Sabbath. Slaves get the weekend, all right? They get time off too. You can't overwork them. You can't abuse them in that sense. They work during the day. They got to be off during the night just like anybody else. And they got Sabbath rest weekly just like anybody else. They also got to take part in the festivals just like everybody else, according to Deuteronomy 16. Sixth point, slaves received mandatory freedom on the Jubilee year. If you want specific passages, let me know. There's not like one verse. It's like a massive amount of verses that talk about Jubilee year, okay? But this would prevent generations from being enslaved. You can't take a family and lock them in. They can choose to stay, but you can't force them to stay. There was Jubilee years that allowed for the slaves to go free, that allowed for them to choose if they wanted to leave, to live a life separate from any master, to have their own endeavors in that sense. I do need to say, I'm almost positive as well, this was applicable to the Jewish slaves, not the nations that they captured. So not the prisoners of war in this case. And as much as I can, I'm gonna tell you which ones. But those are the two that are not applicable to prisoners of war, but they are applicable to the Jewish people. Seven. A master who beat his slave to death was executed. Exodus 21:20 explains this, but it also supports a master's legal right to beat his servant. And so there's a good and there's a bad here in that sense. The question is it morally right for a master to beat his servant? Now, the fact that he'd be killed if he killed his servant, everybody seems to be on board with, okay? Everybody likes that law. And you need to understand that law would prevent severe beating, because if you accidentally killed him, you're gone too. And you'll actually see here in just a moment another regulation that would prevent severe beating. But the question is, if someone's being insubordinate, if someone is harming your family, if someone is destroying your property, that's why this law exists. Just in the same way as if you are in a prison and you are being insubordinate, if you refuse to do what the guards tell you, they're gonna tear gas you in a lot of cases. They're going to come in and tackle you. They are going to beat you, however mean that sounds. That's what happens when you're being disruptive and when you're not doing what you're supposed to do. So it happens in our prison system for people who are harming others, for people who are harming the system and putting other people in danger. And that's what we're talking about here. Severe beating often resulted in freedom for slaves. If you look at Exodus 21, 26 through 27, it says, "If a man strikes the eye of his male or female servant and destroys it, he shall let him go free for the sake of his eye. And if he knocks out the tooth of his male or female servant, he shall let him go free for the sake of his tooth." Now, when you look at the eye specifically, this was a punishment method of some of the pagan nations surrounding them. So when you look at Samson, when they took him slave, one of the things they do is gouged out his eyes. And so God says that's a cruel way to treat your slaves. You're not going to do that. If you gouge out an eye, they go free. If you gouge out an eye, you lose him. You lose her. You aren't allowed to harm him in that way. The tooth one, I think, is the most impressive because it's easy to lose a tooth. All right? If you are beating someone, it's not hard to knock a tooth out. The point is, if even a tooth comes loose, they go free. Yes, you can enforce the rules if they are causing harm. You can punish in that sense, but be very careful. If you kill them, you die, and if you knock their tooth off, you lose them for good. And if you're too harsh, at least with the Jewish ones, they can just go find another master. And so to say that this is anything like the slave trade in America 200 years ago, it's so different. It's nowhere near. This is far, far more comparable to prison, and even better than prison. Far more comparable to prison, and I would prefer this. I would prefer this to prison. That's why that verse said that we read, many of them love their household, love their master and his family, and want to stay. They don't want to go free. This is a great life where many of them are at. And so to say there's any comparison is completely displaying ignorance about what the Bible says. If you just read the word slavery and you don't know better, I understand a lot of people don't know better. But once you know better, it becomes very clear that these are not the same thing. And while it sounds harsh in Scripture to say slave, it wasn't that harsh of a word at that time. Okay? It was restoration, rehabilitation, and a very, very nice prison system. Okay? That's what slavery was in the Old Testament. So we move on to the New Testament. And the criticism changes a little bit. Critics more complain here that God didn't condemn slavery. It's not so much that it's supported throughout the New Testament as much, because at this point, Israel isn't a self-governing nation. The Romans have taken over. So the institutional slave, while it's still going, that's not the New Testament's focus anymore. It's not focused on the nation of Israel as much. Not only does it lack condemnation, there's those few verses that seem to tell slaves they need to be content where they're at, whatever that situation may look like. Colossians 3:22, "Bondservants, obey in all things your masters, according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in sincerity of heart, fearing God." And there's other verses, one of which we read earlier, that do seem to tell slaves, we're not going to skirt around the issue, follow your masters and obey them. Obey what they say. Now, we do need to note that when you look at the New Testament, in Israel, because that's where they're at, all right, most of the New Testament is focused on the Gospels and whatnot, there are still the debt slaves are still part of society. So much of what's being addressed is talking about that scenario still. And so don't think that in the New Testament suddenly we get the slave trade that we think of today. It's still very similar to the Old Testament. The Romans didn't do too much in that department. Israel was still a self-governing, to some extent, nation. The Romans didn't come undo everything. They just have a governor, basically, overseeing and making sure they're paying taxes, etc. So debt slaves were still a part of society, which I think is very moral for someone to go into that type of an institution to pay off and restore what they have damaged or stolen. Second thought, lack of condemnation in a verse isn't condoning the action. So when you look at Matthew 5, 39, but I tell you, everybody's heard this, but I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. This verse is not about how you're allowed to punch people. I mean, but really, it's not saying, and you can slap anybody you want. It's concerned with, when you are wronged, how should you respond? Just because the verse doesn't say they shouldn't have slapped you doesn't mean God is saying, and they were fine in that action. And so lack of condemnation is not condoning an action. Just because God tells slaves to obey your master, just because he tells slaves to do as they're told and to do it well, all right, to do it all unto the Lord, doesn't mean he's saying every scenario of slavery is okay. Now, I honestly don't think God has a problem with debt slavery and using that system to pay off debt and uphold justice. But certainly there are a few instances where people were in a horrible situation, an unjust situation, and God still wants those people to honor him in whatever they're doing. But it doesn't mean God is condoning everything that's being done. He is discussing how do we respond when we're in that type of a situation. Third thought, biblical principles do reject slavery as seen in early America, quite easily. Reject the idea of early American slave trading and what actually still goes around, goes on around the world today. All right, slavery didn't end, but most of us are more familiar with the Civil War time frame than slavery today. Matthew 7, 12, therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Certainly, that's a good verse for, look, who here wants to be kidnapped and sold in slavery? All right, then let's not do that to someone. Who here wants to be beaten? All right, well, let's not, I mean, this verse obviously, and many others, for the sake of time, this is just the example, would apply here and show that we should treat people well, that we should treat people how we want to be treated. Fourth thought for the New Testament. The slave trade is once again rejected in the Bible, in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. 1 Timothy 1, 9 through 10 says, we also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly and sinful, the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their fathers or mothers, for murderers, for the sexually immoral, for those practicing homosexuality, for slave traders and liars and perjurers, and for whatever else is contrary to the sound doctrine. Just kind of thrown in there. Basically for kidnappers who kidnap for the sake of selling is what that means, and that's the slave trade, all right? I mean, directly in the Old Testament, where people think it's the wrathful, vengeful God, he says slave trading's wrong, and it's penalty of death in the Old Testament, okay? As harsh as you can get of a punishment, the New Testament, Paul reiterates, those people who think it's okay to kidnap and sell people, they are not going to the kingdom of God unless they repent. He puts it in with every other major sin you can think of. Slave trading is on the list. So does the Bible support slavery? Define slavery. If you're talking about going and kidnapping people because of their quote-unquote racial appearance, because of their skin color, and then dragging them across the world to sell them into slavery in that sense where they have no rights and their masters can beat them and even kill them without any consequences because they're simply property. If that's what you mean by slavery, nowhere in scripture do we get close to supporting that. If, however, you mean someone who has legitimately trespassed against the law, someone who is a criminal, someone who was an enemy of the state, someone who stole, is in debt, who damaged property, and you use slavery as a way to create restitution, to pay back what is owed, or to bring them into society but still keep an eye on them while treating them well, remembering that you can't severely beat them because if you knock out a tooth, they go free. You can't kill them because then you'll die. Under law, you have to give them rest on the Sabbath. If that's what you're talking about, yes, the Bible does support that. But once again, our prison system is more harsh than that. And everybody here acknowledges that a criminal who robs a bank and goes to jail, that's just justice. That's just what's supposed to happen. There has to be some punishment. Society would fall apart without some structure and some laws, and likewise, Israel had laws. And I think their laws were a little bit better. We just happen to have the word slavery on it, which is a very loaded, emotionally charged term. And rightfully so, when you consider slavery over the past several hundred years. The core issue with the New Testament and the Old Testament, but especially those verses in the New Testament, the Bible is focused on eternity more than it is on present-day life. Okay, in the sense of the Bible is focused on our relationship with God, how to please God, how to know God, how to spend eternity with God, not the how to live the most successful, prosperous life here on earth. Okay? Now, certainly, the Bible says some stuff about finances. It says some stuff about those topics. But its primary focus, look at Romans 6, 16 through 18. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart in the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. The Bible is far more concerned not with our material slavery, okay, for those who were slaves materially, but what our spiritual state is, because Scripture says you are either dead to sin, you are either a slave to sin, or you are alive and a servant of God. Those are the two options. There is not a third, okay? Just want to be very clear. There is not a third option here. Because some people think, well, you could be alive in Christ, or you could be alive in Buddha, or you could be alive. No, no. You are alive in Christ. He has spiritually set you free. He has given you new life. You are a new creation, and you are a bondservant, which means you have chosen to serve God and to follow Him. You are God's servant, all right, made alive through His power and His Spirit. That's option one, or you're a slave to sin, period. You're a slave to sin, or you're alive in Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible is most concerned with. That is why the gospel message is the core of Scripture, because the gospel message is how we can be set free. It's how that debt that we owe can be paid. And as we move on from this class, we are going to talk about that in a lot more detail next week. For those who are not familiar with our outline right now, just for the sake of questions and answers, next week we talk about the quote-unquote genocide in the Old Testament. And so if you're saying, well, sometimes Israel went in and just annihilated everybody, that's next week's topic, okay? Whole class dedicated to that. And so hold off on those questions, but if you have something about slavery specifically, we'll get into Q&A. But then the final week, we go into the topic of hell, which is going to be the ultimate punishment for those who are slaves to sin and have chosen to live a life away from God and in disobedience to God.